theory maintain unitarity. And either today's or the next lecture, we'll also try to perform a more general analysis of unitarity and decoupling of negative norm states, so connected issues, in loop and within string theory. Then we'll go on to discussion of how generals sing beta function equations. Okay, so before we start the analysis of unitarity, there was this issue about the adjoint of operators that we had to clear up from this class. Okay, and so I've actually worked it out carefully, keeping all the dimensions, so let me eliminate these. Okay, so suppose we're working on the cylinder, and the coordinate of the cylinder is W. Now we'll define W to be equal to sigma 1 plus I sigma 2 in Euclidean space. And this is the same. And we'll define sigma 2 is equal to I sigma 2 lambda. Okay, so let's check this is the right thing. So remember that that an action is minus I dt times the integral of potential energy, and we want it to become minus potential energy in Euclidean space. Therefore, it must be that that Lorentzian time is minus I times Euclidean time, or Euclidean time is I times Lorentzian time. Okay, great. So if we wrote W before analytic continuation, we would get W is equal to sigma 1 minus sigma. Okay, the sigma 2 Lorentzian. Now, given an operator O in Lorentz space, we expand it as O is equal to sum over M, O M e to the power minus I M, sigma 2 Lorentzian minus sigma 1. Okay, we're only keeping the analytic expansion, there's an equivalent anti-analytic expansion. But we won't. Right. Okay, so the positive guys have to be, remember, the way to remember this, at least the way I remember it, is that a wave function corresponding to a quantum state, you know, the first quantized wave function corresponding to a quantum state, is obtained by putting the operator, so psi of x, first quantum wave function, the quantized wave function, is 0, x, psi. So we want something with which has positive energy, a state that has positive energy, to correspond to a wave function that has e to the power minus I dt. Okay? Now, something that has positive energy here has a dagger here, so it gets its time dependence from the ax. Okay, suppose x was from harmonic oscillator. Okay, so the time dependence is attached to annihilation operator must be that of a positive energy wave function. Okay? But a positive energy wave function is e to the power minus I dt. Now you remember that positive M was annihilation operators. So positive M should have minus I dt. Okay? There's a useful thing to remember always. It's sort of implicit in some of the notation used in quantum field theory tests, but it's useful to remember, though I generally have to work it out in my head each time, that annihilation operators behave like positive energy wave functions in the sign of that. Okay? So this fixes whether this should have been a plus or a minus, and then the remaining is fixed by the fact that we had this combination, sigma and sigma. Okay, so this was the expansion of O in Lorentzian space. Okay? Now let's convert to Euclidean space. So that is simply sum over M, O M, e to the power minus I M, and then we put minus I sigma 2 minus sigma 1, which is sum over M, O M, e to the power, and now what is this? Minus I M into minus Im into Butsanov plus Im into Dudley. This is the analytic continuation of the Lorentz expansion of O. Okay, let's in parallel write down what the analytic continuation of the Lorentz expansion of O star is. Okay, so O star in Lorentz Lorentzian space is simply M or M star, and then this becomes a minus. Continuation and all that changes is that this sign is negative. So we get O star is equal to sum over M. O M e to the power minus I M. Okay? So if we're working in just in the W plane, then the object that in Lorentzian space was O has this angle. Continuation. The object which in Lorentzian space has O star has this analytic continuation. Notice that it's not the the analytic continuation, the complex conjugate of the analytic continuation of O is not the analytic continuation of O star. Okay? Had it been, we would have changed in addition to making the changing this I, sorry. Yeah. In addition to this I, we would have also had a W bar, but that's not what it is. Right? Because these two operations don't commute, because in between doing the complex conjugation, we change something by an I. So it obviously doesn't commute with the complex conjugation. Okay? But this is the notion of O star that is useful for us. It's the notion of O star that is useful for us in doing calculations about Lorentzian space in analytic continuation. Right? So if we were interested just in the W plane, this would be the natural this would be our definition of complex conjugation in Euclidean space. It would be the definition that would reflect what complex conjugation was in Lorentzian space before doing analytics. Is this clear? Okay? Now that we understand this, all we have to do is to take this result and translate it to the same. Now that is just very easy, because we know how to take an operator and translate it from W to Z. Okay? So, suppose we, our rule was that O of F of W times del F by del W times del F by del W to the power H, and so similarly something will be H bar, we don't keep track of that, is equal to O of W. Now what is F of W? F of W is of course Z, and we define Z to be e to the power minus I W. This is the same thing we did at the end of the last class, but I've now made sure that all dimensions match those Polichinski. Okay, so if you look up Polichinski and you look up the notes from this, you get the same answer. Okay, so Z is equal to e to the power minus I W. Let's check that works. It works because W was sigma 1 plus I sigma 2. The modulus of this mod Z is equal to e to the power I, e to the power sigma 2, as we want. Late times rotate the distance, early time rotate the origin. Okay? And the I is X. Sigma 1 is okay, so this is a nice graph, the definition of Z in terms of W. Now, we need del F by del W, so we need del by del W of e to the power minus I W. So that's simply equal to minus I. Okay? So we get that O of Z, which is simply the insertion in the Z coordinate system. Okay? Is related to an insertion in the W coordinate system by a factor of minus I over Z to the power H. So for Z is equal to 1 over minus I Z to the power H. So okay, and similarly O star of Z. But and by O star I mean the thing that we get from analytically continuing complex multiplication in Lorentz space. Right? So O star of Z is equal to 1 over minus I Z to the power H O star of Z. Okay? And now in the final step, we put in the expansions for O star of W and O star of O of W and O star. So O of W was this, and remembering that Z was equal to e to the power minus I W, we get that O of Z is equal to, let's put I to the power H here. O of Z is equal to I to the power H, and then sum over M, O M Z to the power H plus. Right, because e to the power minus I N W is Z to the power minus I. Okay, whereas O star of Z is equal to I to the power H, sum over M, O M star, or O M star of Z to the power, of Z to the power H minus M. Now, if we happen to be dealing with a real field, a field that was real in Lorentzian space, then O n star would be equal to O of minus n. Okay? So, if we happen to be dealing with a field that is actually this. Let's be more general. I'll just say this in. You see, O n star is the coefficient of plus I. So if you define O star M,
O minus N of star.
Exactly. As the coefficient of e to the power minus I N W. So that's exactly as you said, it's O minus M star. Okay, so O star N is O minus M star, so we put that in here. We have O minus M star. And then we can convert this sum over M into a sum over minus M to write this in a form that looks like this. Okay, now for a reason that I'm not terribly sure I understand, Purchinsky doesn't give any of the motivation of this definition, but he had exactly this. But with an additional factor of minus 1 to the power h. Think it's some funny convention he's dealing with, which I'm not terribly sure of. Okay, but when I mean complex conjugation, this is what I'm going to mean. Okay? And it's probably somebody or the other's conformal field theory.
But that comes from the I to the power h.
Ah, no, wait, but why does that change at all?
Because it's a great minus n. I will go to minus n.
Why will I go to minus n?
Okay. Let's say you wanted to, let's take this same line. You wanted to bring the I inside.
I inside meaning what? Oh, you're saying that we redefine H. Oh, I think you're right. Maybe no.
O star of a zero relation is that so O star.
Well, let's write the form we had before this step. We had sum over M O minus M minus M star over 10 to the power H minus M. And another way of writing this was O. Okay. O star of minus M, which is O of M star.
But there's a minus 1 to the power H also.
Why? Yeah, we'd love that to be
myself. So,
did the ideal part of H just came from the fact that it was a dimension H. O and O star both dimension H.
Is this better? Okay, if you had O of Z as this.
Yes. I actually don't see why. Well, you know, there's a matter of definition here. You can, of course, just redefine what would be by complex multiplication. And as we can see, everything only works with constants. You know, any statement we make would relate only out of constants. So it won't matter in anything physical, I think. I think that basically Kulchinski likes this because. I think there's a formal thing that's nice with the other minus sign. That is, that if you now take z to 1 over z, if you take a complex conjugation plus the conformal transformation z to 1 over z, a real field is self-adjoint, you know, goes into itself under that combined operation with that initial minus. I think that's the reason for putting it there. But okay, I think that we're going to work with this unless we're forced to change for some
Actually,
in
the
z-coordinate,
yes. If you take the complex conjugation, then when you take the complex conjugation of I also? You have defined the O and O star as you did. That was not exactly the complex conjugate of each other.
Right. And then all I did is transform them to Z coordinates.
Right. So now you transform O transform O dot O to the Z coordinate to get this equation. O Z.
Yes.
And then you take a complex conjugate of that.
No, I didn't take a complex conjugate. I took this expression and transformed it.
But why would you?
Because that's not what we're doing. You see, we're not supposed to take complex conjugations after Euclidean rotation. All we're supposed to do is to take the expression that you get, the two different expressions that were complex conjugates of each other in Lorentzian space, and then do all the transformation treating them as independent operators. I never take the complex conjugation.
But the star is really not the star.
It's not the not complex conjugation in
Euclidean. It's actually the conjugation under which there is this. I mean, conjugation of the actual physical inner product.
Exactly. It's the conjugation of the actual physical inner product. That's exactly it.
Hermitian conjugation.
That's exactly right. Okay. In fact, that's the next point. It's the complex conjugation in actual physical space. The thing that we would have, if you use this star, then you will compute the correlation functions of states that you get by, you know, taking the dagger of a state in Lorentzian space. That's what we mean. We're tracing through what we would have done by taking the star of Lorentzian space and then doing the analytic integrations. Then doing the maps. Okay, that's the key point. Okay, so now you can try to convince yourself from this, which just has a formal argument that you can go through, but it's more or less clear from the logic, okay, that this this process of complex conjugation gives you a relationship between the pairing of states that we defined in the previous class, the summological pairing of states. You remember we had this I and J, which meant the I operator inserted at infinity in the U equals 1 by Z chart. Okay? The two-point function of that with the J operator inserted at 0. That gave us, that was well defined, if you remember. You know, the powers of Z cancelled between the translation of the operator from the Z chart to the U chart and the explicit powers of Z that appear in the two-point function. That gave us pairing of states, or at least a pairing of operators. Now, there's a natural question to ask, okay? It's a natural question to ask, let's call it OI. It's a natural question to ask how this thing is related to the pairing of states that you get from the inner product, or the pairing of operators that you get from the inner product using the state operator map. Okay? And I came to the answer is simply that this is OI star OJ. Where on the right hand side I've written the usual inner product. Or maybe another way of saying it, that's a better way of saying it. OI OJ. Okay? In Puchinsky chapter 6, he gives a formal sort of quote unquote demonstration, not a very convincing demonstration of this statement. I think you'll find it more convincing if you just think through the logic of what this OI star was. Okay? You'll see that putting this thing and using the state operator map defines the insertion of the state in the get sense on the other side. And I think this is most useful to just sit and think through yourself. I could, if you have questions about it, you can ask me next class. But so let's leave this as an exercise. Convince yourself that it's true. Okay, great. So that ends the discussion that I plan to have about general properties of operator insertions, general properties of operator insertions on the sphere interpreted in Hilbert space language. You see, if you think about it now, you put together what we discussed last class and in today's class, we have a complete Hilbert space understanding of any correlation function that you like to write down on the sphere. You can translate that to Hilbert space language. So just to review for you, the correlation function of two operators, one at 0, one at infinity, we've related to the two-point function of two states. The correlation functions of two operators, one at 0 and one at two different finite points, is also related to the inner product between two states, because we saw that could be written, that we saw that OI of 0, OI of Z1, OJ of Z2 could be written as GIJ over Z1, 2 to the power of H. 2H. Okay? And GIJ was the two-point function of OI with OJ star. Okay? Great. Then we also have a Hilbert space interpretation of three or four-point functions. Okay, so let's look for instance at three-point functions. Okay, so what about a three-point function? Suppose you had, let's do a notation as. So suppose we had a I prime and suppose you had a I prime at infinity. Remember, the prime says it refers the operator to the 1 by u chart. But that's the same thing because these are assumed to be tensor operators. Okay? That's the same thing as AI, but with that additional with an initial power of z, it will just make all this point. Okay? So suppose here I have a prime of infinity ak of 1 and a
j of 0.
Okay. So now what is this in operator land? Somebody tell me. How would you write this in operator language? Okay. The answer is so obvious that you don't know what to answer. The answer simply this is this I. Now what this means in terms of ordinary inner products, you know, is this. So this is simply a matrix element. It's simply a matrix element between this state and this state of this operator. Is this clear? Okay. Similarly, now if you have some z, z here, you'd have this z dependence, which you could pull out by understanding how z dependence in an operator. Basically, you have z to the power l naught on the left and z to the power minus l naught on the right. Okay, so you just get the l naught dependences. So, what makes sense? I'm saying that ak or any operator of z to z bar is equal to z to the power l naught, z bar to the power l naught bar, ak 1 1. Times this is the usual statement of time evolution and then analytically continued. Okay, just like we did, you write down how an operator evolves in time and in space, you know, in Lorentzian space. And then analytically continue that statement. Again, you just get this. Okay? So, remember that this operator, you know, we evaluate this state by the state operator map. Remember? That we evaluate. Oops. That according to our conventions, we evaluate a state by state operator map by inserting an operator at the origin and doing the path integral of the unit list. That's why I was particularly interested in evaluating an operator inserted at the unit list, because it acts on that state. It's just the usual Hilbert space operation of an operator on the state. Okay? If we had it at some other time, it would be acting on that state. But we can easily factor out the time dependence using time evolution and then act on that state. Okay? So this quantity is that, and last class we also saw that it evaluated to Cijk, or Ikj in this way of writing it, times those powers of z, which are not determined. Okay? So now we've got a very, in particular, this object, the three-point function at 1, 1 is simply this, the matrix element of the operator AK, 1, 1 between these two states. Okay? And that quantity is CIJK. With everything written lower, and remember I mentioned that we're lowering indices using these, this homological metric of two-point functions in this, this double-end two-point functions. And so on. Okay, we're still going to see how similar things work for four-point functions. That would be the heart of our discussion in the unit. Okay, so, but any questions or comments? So, the point of all of this was to take expressions that we've written in path integral language and give these expressions a Hilbert space interpretation. Okay? Now we're going to use that Hilbert space interpretation to understand the structure of singularities in three-level diagrams, to understand the structure of singularities in three-level diagrams in string theory, a diagram from the sphere in string theory. But any questions or comments about this? Okay, great. So, now let's that you remember that the amplitude of that of, okay, suppose we were interested in four point scattering of four different states. Let me make sure I stick to just this notation. So I'm interested in the four point scattering of the states 1, 2, he's got 4, 3. So suppose I'm interested in the scattering amplitude that is evaluated by E to Z of V1 at infinity in infinity. And I'm going to put a hat and explain what that means. V2 hat at 1, 1. V3 hat at 0, and V4 hat at, no, no hat, at Z. Okay, you remember that our general evaluation of the four-point function of particles 1, 2, 3, and 4 evaluated to this expression where hat implies also put the C insertions. Include also the C insertions. Okay? And no hat implies no hat C insertion. Now, the operators without the C insertions are 1, 1 operators. The operators with the C insertions are 0, 0 operators. The many nice things about 0, 0 operators. Okay, for instance, one nice thing about the 0, 0 operator is that the insertion of an operator in any frame is the same thing. Z frame or the W frame is the same thing because you have powers of 1 over Z squared to the power A. If the H is 0, it doesn't matter. Okay? So for formal reasons and principles of aesthetic appeal, I'm going to transform this expression into an expression involving only 0, 0 operators. So I'm going to make V4 an operator with a hat. How do I do this? Well, in order to do this, I use the following relationship. I use the relationship that V4 of Z, Z bar is equal to 1 over Z, Z bar anti-commutator V0 anti-commutator of V0 tilde V4 of Z. And complete the angle. Oh, why is this true? Why is this true? Well, this is meant to be a statement for the purposes of insertion into this relationship. Not as a general statement about the operator, just for the purpose of insertion into this relationship. Okay, now you see, for the purpose of inserting into this relation, this V4 dressed is dressed with C's. But we know that the only thing that we have to worry about is the part of C that is the zero. The part of C that involves the zero points for all such insertions. Okay? So it's very easy to just plug in what C is here. So C is equal to Cm Z by M plus 1. 1 over Z by M minus 1. This is weight minus 1 operator. Okay? Even without the other statement, you just plug this in.
In the dimensions we are using, is there an I to the power H or not?
My God. I to the power H, where?
In this definition, in this expansion, C is equal to, here I would have expected an I.
Okay, good point. Let's see.
Maybe I think I to the power H is absorbed and that's where the minus is.
Maybe that's it. You're right that we would have expected an I factor, which would have squared, that's probably a minus. Maybe the minus sign. Let's do the calculation. Okay, maybe it comes out of this without. Let's do the calculation. So V hat is equal to V of Z is Z bar times C of Z times C of Z bar. V bar. Okay, now we put the expansion for C. Okay, so this is equal to V of Z Z bar sum over M C M. I will put an arbitrary constant and see what that looks out to. Cm over z to the power m minus 1, Cm star, or C bar, m over z bar to the power m minus 1. Okay, now we take this commutator. This commutator pulls out the C0 term, and now the other anti commutator. But, okay, so let's do the signs here. So many initial samples. I think we do get a minus. You see, let's take this commutator. So this is, so suppose we've written it this way. You see, let's work out what this commutator is. This commutator is B0, C of Z, let's say B0 till Z bar, C of Z, and only C0 matters clearly, so I'll write C by Z bar, C0 bar, minus C of Z, C0 bar is zero. Okay? Now we have to take this B0 through C. So that gives us minus. So it's minus of anti-commutator B0 bar with C0 bar. Now anti-commutator is plus 1. So this term is equal to minus C of Z. Okay? So that's the minus C of Z here. And then B0 with C of Z just gives you C, just gives you 1, clicking with only the C0. So we pick up a minus sign. So we get that this thing here is equal to minus of V of Z, Z bar with alpha. Okay, now the term that you wanted was an I to the power H. H was 1, but there are two such terms because there was a C and a C bar. Okay, I'm going to say I give up here. Okay, okay, we have to trace through the factors. Maybe this is something. Sorry, up to some factor of I's. I'm not sure. Okay, if you want to do it for real calculation, you have to be very careful. Okay. Okay, sorry. So, okay, so the point is that this quantity here can be rewritten as the correlating function of this. Of this active object along with these other insertions of B. Is that it? Okay? So now what we're going to do, is to take this object and rewrite it in inverse Fixed dimension. Okay. So what about this object? So suppose we had well, let's first deal with V of Z, and then we'll substitute once we've written that expression. So, suppose, what about this object? Suppose we have V1 hat of infinity, infinity, V2 hat of 1, 1, and then I'm going to be cavalier with signs as, you know, right, this is V4. I should be keeping track of signs, but I really want to add. If the fermionic actually keeping track of signs, the bosonic should be there in the ones. Z Z bar, V3 hat of 0, 0. Okay? And I want to give again an inverse space interpretation of this one. So now what is that? Well, it's very similar to what we did for 3-point functions, except it's a 4-point function. Because it's a 4-point function, it's inside a path integral, it's a correlation function of some operators. But remember the operator is time ordered. Okay, time ordered when after analytic continuation amounts to radio. Okay? Remember, quantum mechanics always reads things, you know, like Hebrew, Arabic. You know, so the thing which first appears to the right. Okay? So when Z is greater than 1, mod Z is greater than 1, this guy is first. So we have theta of mod Z minus 1 times V1 hat, and then we get, since this V4 Z Z bar V2 hat 1 1 and then V3 V3 hat okay, and plus we have one more term which is plus theta of 1 minus 1 Z V1 hat V2 hat 1 1 V4 Z Z bar and V3. Okay. Now the next step what I do is to substitute these guys. So let me deal with one of these two expressions. You can manipulate the second one in exactly the same way. Let me deal with the first of these two expressions. Okay? So with the first of these two expressions, we're going to get a theta of mod z minus 1 times v1 hat. Now we substitute this in, so we get divided by z z bar. V naught hat, V hat of Z Z bar, V, what is it, 4, V2 hat of 1, 1, and then V3. This thing looks complicated, but now the next step we take is to remember that all of these states are physical states of string theory. These are the only states that we can. Okay? So in particular, these states are all annihilated by reason. Okay? So all these expressions which involve a B0 either completely to the left, or at least one of B0, B0 bar on the left is just 0. This is that highlights this V1 here. Okay? So the only part of the four terms that contribute when you write this thing out is the terms in which both B0 and B0 bar are to the right. Okay? So not keeping track of signs of any sort. This is the same thing as picked up on Z minus 1 over Z Z bar times V1 hat. V4 hat of Z, Z bar, V0, V0 bar, times V2, 1, 1, and then V3. Okay. Now, in the next step, I evaluate the time dependence. Okay. I evaluate the time dependence of the subject. I evaluate the time dependence, and let me get which one is to the left and which one. Right. So, using that B4 hat of Z and Z bar is equal to Z to the pi is not Z bar to the pi is not bar V4 hat of 1 1 okay, times z to the power minus L naught, z bar to the power minus L naught. And using the fact that V1 hat has L naught equals L naught bar equals 0. Remember, it's physical state of string theory. So the matter part of it has L naught equals L naught bar equals 1. But there's also the cost part of it, which is minus 1. Okay? So the full L naught bar, all physical states. Remember, we have every operator now in the hat dimension. It has the C stuff inside. That's the great thing. Dimension 0. So L naught equals 0. Okay? Because of that, the part in which this guy acts to the left just gives you 1. But the part in which it acts to the right survives. So this term is theta of mod z minus 1. And now we write this as V1 hat, V4 hat, 1, 1. Then z to the power L naught minus 1, where the minus 1 is this z in the denominator, z bar to the power L naught bar minus 1, and V2, 1, 1, and V3. Okay? So that's what this thing evaluates to in Hilbert space language. Now this still seems pretty complicated because of this z to the power L0 minus 1 and z. Oh, and then I get a sign wrong, this is the minus. Because it was a bar. It has a minus. Alright, now this still seems pretty complicated. In order to understand, you see what we did. We have to do an integral over z. So we want to understand the z dependence of this object. But this seems pretty complicated because this z multiplies an operator. Okay? So in order to simplify it, what we'll do is to insert a complete set of states into it. Okay? So let's take this object here. And insert a complete set of states. So we put theta mod z minus 1 times v1 hat, v4 hat, and I'm sorry, I have not written the b0s. There's a b0, b0. I can choose either, but let me insert the complete set of states after the b0. So we've got b0, b0 bar, and then we get, let's call it psi. Psi, and then we get z to the power minus L of psi. So let's keep taking set of z. Sum over all states psi, z to the power L of psi minus 1, z bar to the power L of L bar of psi minus 1, times V1 hat, V4 hat of 1, 1, V0 bar, psi, and then psi times V2, 1, 1, and me. Okay. Great. Now we're almost through. You see, now we're almost through because, let's see, we know what the full state of size is. The set of all psi's are given by all vertex operators in the theory, dressed with an e to the power ikx. Okay? Now, if that psi were to be associated with a particle of mass m, so let's suppose that this psi is some vertex operator and in pi here. And suppose the weight of psi was such that it would have been associated with a particle of weight m. Then we know that the dimension of this operator is equal to string. Yeah. It's k squared plus m squared by 4 and don't forget. The L naught dimension. Alpha prime k squared by 4 is the standard is the standard dimension of e to pi kx, the thing we've computed. And we know that m enters, I mean more or less by definition, m enters into this relation by computing this k squared and k squared by 6. Okay, so we can label the operators by the dimension. But instead, I choose to label them by the mass of the particle they would have corresponded to if they were a physical state too. Just by using the relationship between L naught and mass. Right? The relationship being the relationship we've seen many times, just to write that explicitly, that m squared is equal to 4 divided by alpha prime into the L naught of the operator, not including its momentum, but including its C hat. That's that minus 1. Not either as L naught minus 1, but I'm writing it as the full L naught, including the C hat contribution, so this is minus 1. Okay, so this M squared, if you like, is just some label for the dimension of the operator, just labeling the L naught of that operator in some function. Okay, I invite you in this way because we want to interpret in space sense. Is this clear? Okay, fine. So this term here we can rewrite. This term here we can rewrite as now this sum over all the states includes an integral over all the eta and sum over all vertex. Is this clear? Remember, the first two, three lectures of this course, we worked out the Hilbert space of free bosons. So what was the Hilbert space? It was specified by occupation numbers of the oscillators times the wave function 0. So if you want to do the full completeness over Hilbert space, you have to sum over all occupation numbers and occupation number basis of the oscillators, and also sum over the 0 mode wave function. Right? So the sum of the 0 mode wave function is some integral over k. So we get some integral over k, some d, whatever, dk, d minus 1 k by 2 pi to the power k. I'm actually now going to keep track of the numbers too carefully here. Wilczynski in this chapter has kept very careful track of all of these things, just to see that it works out, you know, really perfectly. I'm just going to let you, give you a sense for the structure of it. Leave you to work out the coefficients, if you're interested. Okay, so we've got d, dk. And then we also have a sum over all states, over all particles. That's this sum here. Then the z dependence is z to the power alpha prime over k squared plus m particle squared over 4, similarly to z bar. And then we have these two different objects. V1 hat, V4 hat,
minus one.
Oh, yes, thank you. This
way. Minus one.
Ah, and there's minus one. I had minus up here. Minus L0 minus one. Okay, so the answer is 120. Okay?
So,
well,
basically we've obtained the propagator.
We've obtained the propagator, exactly. Now, you know, when this thing is not in the range where it's convergent, we're going to define it by analytic continuation. So, if you remember, in the form of the expression that we had, even before Tachyon's catalytic, the integral was not manifestly convergent, in fact, was not in general convergent. But what we did is we moved to some region of K-space where the thing was manifestly convergent. You know, to go to some very large space like momentum for this K. So, for any given mass, you can always find a space, a momentum that's, you know, large enough so that this thing is convergent. Okay, evaluate it there and say that the actual expression is what is defined by analytic continuation of that expression. Okay, so that's what we're doing. So what we have here is it's just the answer for the expression. We just replace this by the propagator. Is this clear? So what we've got now is that this question, this business here. So this business here is V1 at V4 at V0, V0, V0 bar, Vp, Vp, V, V3 times 8 pi. It's precarious to keep track of numbers with the level of decay that we're doing it, but I think this 8 is what we're doing here. You see, we had 4 pi here, and we could have got 16 because there's a 1 over 4 here. So. But there's a half here. So 8 pi over alpha prime to k squared plus n squared. And, you know, when we do the analytic continuation right, we should get the right minus I epsilon. If we wanted to reduce that, you know, we're analytically continuing and approaching the axis where there's a curve from the right side. Okay, great. That,
okay.
We now still have to sum over all the particles. Well, you see, what the aim of this is to try to show that the string 4-point amplitude is consistent with unitarity.
Okay, which we can show by thinking, I mean, the usual propagator arguments.
You see, basically what we've done is to show that the amplitude is of the usual field theory form. That was not all manifest, right? There's some 4-point insertion and an integral over moduli space. And what does that have to do with exchange of particles? Okay? What we've done is taken this expression here and cast it into a form such that it's manifestly the product of two 3-point interactions with the propagator of that intermediate particle going into three dynamics.
Okay, this is slightly. So what are the maybe you would have expected that, you know, like, structure all particles, there may be some 4-point vertices.
There might be 4-point vertices, but those don't lead to singularities. You see, the only what we're going to do, as you see, is to isolate all imaginary pieces in the. You see, for instance, from this point of view, we've only done a part of the integral. There's the other term where we have to do the integral from mod z from 1 to 0. Okay? So there's more stuff going on. But what we're interested in is not the full answer, but the singularities of the answer, the imaginary part of this amplitude. as you know, imaginary paths only appear when particles run in, when there is an intermediate particle going on chain. Okay? So if there was a direct four-point interaction, which in general there will be, okay, that's there, but it doesn't contribute to the imaginary particle. The only contribution at three level to imaginary parts of amplitudes in a four-point function is 2 3-point functions with a particle propagating. That's what we're trying to isolate. Is this clear?
Can you tell me where the 4-point functions are appearing?
Yes, you see, what we have done here, let's look at the other stuff. In the other stuff, what were the differences?
The default would be on the other side of.
Exactly. So now this k here is the k of b1 plus b4.
Yes, yes.
Okay? So this is giving you all only the terms which have singularities in t1, k1 plus k4, whatever that is, t or something like that. Okay? All the other terms appear, but they just don't contribute to singularities. But they contribute, right? So you would have to. Okay? So this part is just exactly this sum. But there's all the other stuff, it's totally non singular. You have singularities in some other, in some S.
Okay. So if the statement that, you know, like, you can just give all the 50 amplitudes, all the 4-point.
Yes, so if you were to isolate the correct field theory amplitudes, this would, at tree level, just be given by the Feynman graphs of field theory. But you don't a priori know what the correct field theory amplitudes are.
No, I mean, this is the way.
This is the way I'm determined.
For example, the a priori alpha prime would be the particular factor.
This thing, you know, is just reconstructing these graphs. But from the other stuff, you get the format. Exactly. So that's in fact, you know, suppose you wanted to, in the gravity effect of action, you wanted to compute some 6 graph on vertex. You would take the full 6 graph dot scattering amplitude, throw out the parts that came from lower amplitudes propagating in trees, and what's left is the 6 graph dot. That's how you would actually do it. You would use this expansion for that. You'd use the full gamma function answer, subtract out all the stuff running, and then evaluate the remaining thing. That would be finite, okay? And that would be the 6 graviton matrix. So it certainly exists, it's there. It's just that here what we're trying to do is isolate the singularities in T. Is this clear? Okay? Fine. So now Pulchinski goes through a song and dance after this. To show that this answer is So now, you can evaluate all singularities in this diagram as a function of t, if you want to do, simply by replacing this 1 over k squared plus by I pi times the delta function. Okay, and then you could go ahead and show that this obeys Kutkowski's rules. Okay, where the 3-point scattering vertices are given by this. But since this is already now the Feynman diagram form, and since Feynman diagrams have this property that they obey these scattering amplitudes, there's really nothing more to do. Okay? We've recast this thing into the form of a field theory with certain 3-point functions and a field theory propagator. So the unitarity relations will be manifest, provided you appropriately choose the 3-point, provided the 3-point function that chose is appropriate. But these are the 3-point. Yes. Good. Let's start with that. Ignoring that okay, for a moment. Okay.
We would have expected both of them to be of the same color, right? Because this was a 3-point.
Yeah. But now the U is basically. Now we can finish this one.
No.
We just use the physical statement. I'm just wondering if I said something wrong earlier.
Just one.
three axes. You see, what that V0 should be doing is projecting onto this physical space. It's only one second.
Oh, I know.
So,
forward
Yes. It's going the other way. So, let me tell you what. That's, of course, a very important point. Physical states are annihilated by let's say this here. You see, this is right, it's confusing. Remember, there's this, okay, and there should, okay, let me do it more. This is PP prime and GP prime. You, when you insert a complete set of states, oh, it actually probably be when you insert the complete set of states, we're doing it in order to get not this Hilbert space product, but insertions of operators, because we want scattering amplitudes. Of course, these things are simply related to each other, right? Conjugation. But it's important that we got this factor of GPP prime up here. Okay, now let's see why that makes difference. You see, suppose P is a physical state. Okay? P is a physical state, so it's annihilated by V0 and V0. Okay? Now, if you want to find if you want to find the state with which this connects using this inverse propagator, I think this will be the state that is not annihilated. You see, there were the up states and the down states. And we had up equals 0, right? Okay. Since we've got 2 minutes, let me make what I think is the statement, and I'll check it and tell you about it next time. But what I think is the statement is going to be this. You see, this P here will be a physical state that's annihilated by the V0 and V0 bar operators. Okay? Now, this guy, that will force this guy to be, it's a partner state. So, suppose those were the down states. Okay? That will force this guy to be the up states. Meaning, only the only non-zero GPP prime elements will be between up and down. Okay? So that this BV0 on the up will give you the down. Okay? Understand the statement? I can't see why this is true at the moment.
But this is because G is off diagonal
in BC. That's right.
Because the BC which OPE that gives you a...
That's exactly right. Because it's the BC OPE that gives you. That's basically the point. Yeah, so exactly. Yeah, that is actually, you just said it. So, no, I have just said it. You know, the reason that we were looking at the down states is that we were dressing every operator with a C. But if you want to have non-zero two-point function, then you want to have this guy dressed with a B. You know, the other way around. So, this character, which annihilates, you know, one set, will... I'm going to have to work this out to be careful, but it's exactly what you said. You see, suppose we're looking at operators that are annihilated by B. The corresponding guys with which they have non-zero two-point function will be annihilated instead by C. Okay? So, by C0. So B0 on that operator will not be annihilated, but instead will give you a physical operator. Will give you an operator that is in the down level basis. Okay? So it's exactly what you want. So I'll give you a formula for this next class. But I think this is exactly what you want. You see, this is physical. And this, because of the presence of the BB0, is also physical. It's also annihilated by this. It's clearly annihilated by B0 because the explicit factors, yeah? But this is non-zero. Is this clear? I mean, it's not completely clear because I haven't given you the formula, but I think the idea is completely right. Okay, good. So, firstly, because of this factor, this will be an ordinary inner product of something with the same thing, you know, mod square of a three-part function. But now there's another important point, which I'm not sure we'll get to, but I mean, that's right. The other important point is that, you see, what we used here was the summation over all states in the conformal field. However, in string theory, you know, from the point of view of space-time, you should only have appearing inside this propagating set of states those states that are physical. Now, not all states of the Hilbert space of string theory are physical. Sorry, of the conformal theory are physical. Only those states that lie in cube cohomology are physical. Okay? Probably need to go. Let me at least quickly tell you the idea. Okay? So, this is almost what you want, but not quite yet. Because we have to show that we don't get spurious poles from unphysical states propagating each other. This is the key point. Of unity, exactly. Okay? So we have to show that only physical states contribute in this running in the middle. Now that is true. That is true. I probably can't give you the proof before Partha starts the seminar, but let me tell you the main idea. You see, there are two kinds of states that you could worry about. There are the states that are Q exact. Or the states that are just not Q closed. Now the states that are Q exact clearly don't contribute. Because suppose VP was equal to Q on some VP prime. Okay, then we can write this and Q annihilates this and annihilates that, so you take the Q through and you can see. Okay? So the Q exact states are clearly not a problem. Okay. What about the states that are not Q closed? Well, the point is that since Q squares to 0, Q has the representation of Q on a Hilbert space is very simple. The representation theory of Q on a Hilbert space is very simple. There are those states that are annihilated by Q. And the states that are not annihilated by Q appear in pairs. The pairs being the state that's not annihilated by Q and the next one, that's exact. So the representation theory of Q is made up of those guys that are annihilated by Q, those are the physical state. And then those guys that don't annihilate Q pair with an exact state. Okay? And as I'll show you in formulas next class, basically what you can do is to write this complete set of states. We're through in a minute. You write this complete set of states in terms of a projector on which one side of the projector is always a Q exact state.